Let me show you a picture of five U.S. presidents receiving a message from Dr. Lee Graham. And good, I'm going to put it up. Dr. Graham was asked to speak and to conduct President Richard Nixon's funeral in 1994, when Nixon passed away. And five of our presidents were alive, able to come to the funeral. And there was a picture of them all sitting together with their spouses. And they are hearing the Word of God. And his name doesn't water down. He preaches the gospel. He made reference to the song Amazing Grace. He quoted the song Amazing Grace. And he also told how John Newton was converted to Jesus Christ, a slave ship captain, become Christian, and how John Newton influenced Wilbur Wilberforce in the British Parliament to change the slavery laws. So the effect of the church on the state was plainly laid out before our presidents and before many dignitaries. And we're going to talk about that today. The difference between church and state, and how the church, we can present our views at any time. There's no restriction. So if you look with me into today's reading, that we're going to hear from Paul reading, speaking to Timothy, writing to Timothy. If you would stand as I read the first letter to Timothy, chapter 2, verses 1 to 4, we'll hear about how Paul calls us to pray for all those in authority. Paul writes, "Therefore, I exhort first of all that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
We're taught and told not to talk about politics and religion. Talk about anything you want, politics and religion. Well, you need to talk about politics and religion. And you all feel released and free to talk about politics and religion. You see, the message title is The Power of Choice. We all have a choice what we're going to believe, what we're going to do, how we're going to vote. The choice was given to us by God. So talking about politics and religion for a moment, let's talk about the choice of our U.S. presidents and their religion. Did religion matter to them? Did Christianity affect them? Were there other religions in the White House? I've studied up on this and learned that 37 of our 43 U.S. presidents were Christian, named Christian faith, and named the particular denomination they're a part of. Four of our presidents were Unitarians, and I do not count that as Christian. And two of our presidents did not specify any religion. Of these 37 U.S. presidents, 11 of them were Episcopalian. The Episcopal Church is actually the Church of England here in America. 8 of them were Presbyterians, 4 were Baptists, 3 were Methodists, and 2 were Quakers. And that funeral service for Richard Nixon, Mr. Richard was a Quaker, so Billy Graham spoke at a Quaker funeral. 37 U.S. presidents, Christian. You can't tell me there's no connection between religion and politics. Politics and religion. But then you might raise up the issue, you know, Brother Steve, there's a separation of church and state. You shouldn't even be talking about this. We're monitoring you. Or you come to your house, you're in trouble. That can't happen in America. Although you never know when winds change, you think about that. There was one mayor in Houston who wanted to see all the sermons preached when it was Houston. All the preachers had to show her their sermons. You can't do that. And they had a big to-do about that, and she went there. There is a separation between church and and state, but it's not between church and state, it's between state and church. Let's go back to what Thomas Jefferson actually wrote, what our Sixth Amendment to the U.S. Constitution is, and what it really is, the law. Because some folks who don't want the church to have a voice, because if we ever had a voice, we have so many people, we could vote every right person in office. Some have said the separation of church and state means the church cannot affect the state. The church cannot speak up and vote and have influence on the Congress or the legislature. No, the church must remain quiet, remain to itself, remain in its doors. That's a lie. The law was made, the amendment was made in the Constitution. Let me read just a few lines from a letter from Thomas Jefferson to the Danbury Baptists, showing what this law, this amendment, really means, and showing Jefferson's respect for it. He wrote, "I contemplate with sovereign reverence," he has respected this law, "that act of the whole American people, being the two-thirds majority, to pass an amendment, which declared that their legislature should make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, thus building a wall of separation between church and state." Historically, this is the first time that phrase, separation of church and state, was used. It's in 1802 that Jefferson wrote this letter. But it might have been more clear if he had written a wall of separation between state and church. The law says the state cannot come into the church and tell the church what to do. In England, the state took over the church. In England, the King of England told the Pope, "I am taking my whole church out of the Roman Catholic Church and creating the Church of England." He can't do that. But King Henry did. So in the United States, we said, "We're not going to do that. The legislature, you cannot make a law against the church. The government cannot come into this room and tell you to stop preaching, tell you to stop singing, tell you you can't raise your hands, tell you you can't kneel down." They cannot do that. They can make no law prohibiting the free exercise of religion. Now, we're not the only religion. I wish they had specified Christianity, but they didn't. And Thomas Jefferson was not a born-again Christian, and yet he supported this amendment. Thomas Jefferson was a deist. He believed in rationalism and observation of creation, and he could tell there's a creator and tell there's a God. Okay, that's good, Thomas. But he didn't believe Jesus was the Son of God. So here is a rational person of religion supporting this law. So we are completely free to express our power of choice in any election, in any speech, in any bumper sticker, in any sign we hold up. But we, of course, have to read the rest of the word, which says to be polite, be appropriate, don't be unruly, be respectful. And if you're polite and respectful, you can talk about politics and religion. Now, if you're not polite, you're not respectful, you better not start. Congress cannot restrict religion, but we can influence the Congress. We can call our legislators, we can write letters, we can sign a petition, even as a whole congregation, we could, and send it on. I've had legislators write back to me, acknowledging my request and expressing their view of what they're going to do. So we can affect the Congress, we can affect the legislature, and Paul is telling Timothy here 2,000 years ago, he is calling for the influence of prayer. The first influence we want upon our legislators is prayer. He calls, first of all, prayer. And prayer is a giving thanks to be made for kings and all who are in authority. All who are in authority. So does praying for the president matter? Does praying for the judge executive, praying for the mayor, praying for the governor matter? Yes. There is a purpose for these prayers, there's a reason for these prayers, and there's a good outcome for these prayers. And if we don't pray and the leaders don't do our society will fall apart. And worse, people will not come to know Jesus as Savior and Lord. Now, this is in these four verses. I'll take you step by step through that in just a moment. First, I want to say, perhaps the greatest gift God gave to us in our creation was giving us a free will. He did not make us as robots. He did not make us as clones. We have a free will. We can choose what to do. We can choose what to think. We can choose to obey Him. We can choose to disobey Him. He took the risk of giving us a free will. He's probably scratching his head, wondering if he should have done that. He left us one obedience test in the Garden of Eden, you know all that I'm talking about. He had a tree called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He told Adam and Eve, don't eat of that tree. You can eat of any other tree, including the tree of life. But you cannot eat of this tree. It's your choice. And the serpent came in, lied to Eve, got her interested in that tree. And she, in the end, she chose to eat the fruit. Her own choice. And she didn't have it because he ate it. And they chose to disobey God. Now the tree, the fruit, I believe the fruit was not deadly. But the disobedience was deadly. That caused Adam and Eve's death. So our choices have consequences. We want to make the right choices. We want to follow God. We don't have to. Now, Simpson, I was glad I was out at your house last night or yesterday morning. I'm glad we got to talk to each other. And in our visit, Mr. Simpson told me about World War II. He was on the front lines, the U.S. Army in Germany, maybe in France. Shirley said there was a time when there was a whole month couldn't even change his clothes. The battle was so strong and intense, there was no time to wash up and change the clothes. He was on that front line. He was not a 91-year-old man when he went to Europe. He was an 18-year-old man. How many 18-year-olds, let's see, 60 or 70 years ago, Simpson, how many of you all actually leave Adair County and go somewhere else? I might go to Green County, I might go to Russell County, but how many of you all would leave and go far away? He didn't. Transportation was slow. So Simpson went from Adair County to Europe in the U.S. military and fought. He told me we were scared. He said, I was scared. I believe it. If someone came to me, I'd be scared. He said, all men were scared. We wanted to run. We wanted to run for our life. They chose to stay in the battle, to fight the good fight, and God gave victory. It was a terrible battle. He told of men killed next to him. Terrible battle. But we won. God gave that victory because it was right. This power of choice is very important. As Mr. Simpson didn't turn his back on, he didn't make the wrong choice to run, he made the right choice to stay and fight. It's the same for us today. We've got to make the right choices in pray, and then act. Let me come right down to this. Number one, if we look at this text this morning, Paul is calling us to pray for those in authority. He says, first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and all who are authority. All who are authority. And then he gives two reasons for these prayers. Two outcomes for these prayers. First outcome, so they can provide, a peaceable culture. A peaceable culture. And the word says that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. When you drove out of your driveway this morning, did you drive for a peaceful community? Yes. Because our leaders are doing their job. Not every country can say that. Quiet and peaceable life. Our leaders are raised up to provide a peaceable culture. Fair, peace kept, order kept. That's their job. children are respectful to their teachers, are respectful to their parents and their grandparents. They say please, they say thank you. They're polite. Isn't reverence wonderful? And when the people of the community, the men, women, and children, all reverence God in Jesus Christ, isn't that right? It's beautiful. I'm glad we live in a community like that. The community reverences God. But the ultimate outcome of this praying for our leaders is not for a peaceful community. It's that all men would be saved. If you keep reading and you carefully piece together what Paul has said, he has said that they may have a quiet and peaceful life in godliness and reverence. This is pleasing to God because God desires all men to be saved. All men, women, and youth and children will be saved in a culture that promotes Jesus Christ, that lives Jesus Christ, that offers Jesus Christ, and that reverences Jesus Christ. People will come to a saving knowledge of Jesus. Now, does this happen in a Muslim culture, country or in a Muslim city? No. Because they promote a different religion, different God. So prayers make a difference. All right, we're going to zoom in more, right on 3 points. Three things to say about your power of choice. We don't have to pray for presidents. We don't have to have a reverent community. We don't have to lead people to know Jesus. But the first point is make it personal. Make it personal for you and me that we are going to make a difference in our community. We are going to foster not just religion, but Christianity. Not deism, not rationalism, but Christianity with Jesus Christ, God incarnate, God in the flesh. The Savior gave his life on the cross to pay for our sins. The Savior bodily resurrected, who sits at the right hand of God right now. Now some would say those are radical claims. They are. They are. That our Master was resurrected is a radical claim. But the apostles claimed it to their death. So it's true. They would have turned and run if that wasn't true, but it was true. Jesus resurrected. Let's make it personal. Jesus has personally sought you, he bought you, he has taught you, and he has brought you to this day and this week. There are no spectators here. I just assumed coming down and sit among you. Last week at some manner, they didn't have a pulpit, so I just sat in a chair and I talked to her, but I just assumed sit in the chair and talk to you. And you can talk back. I'm no different than you. There are no spectators here. This is not a show. This is a service. And you all are the servants. We're all serving God. We're singing songs to Him, bringing praise to Him, giving offering to Him. It's about Him. No spectators. You know what makes me feel confirmed in this? Last night, I left here with Billy Graham, 9 o'clock on Saturday night, just to get me going. Last night, Billy Graham said to that audience, there are no spectators here. I said, oh, that's what I know, Billy. I appreciate my Billy Graham. I have feeling good. There are no spectators. Jesus told every disciple to be light and to be salt. Peter told us all to be living stones built up into a body. Paul told us to be the aroma of Christ and an ambassador for Christ. An ambassador is one sent by one king to another king to represent him. We are sent by our king, the Lord Jesus, to represent him to this American culture. And we've got to represent him well. You will know a country by its ambassador. Let's make it personal. I'm going to jump down to number 2.2, make it prayerful. Let's make it prayerful. We can choose to pray or we can choose not to pray. We can do our own thinking or not do our own thinking. We can ask God for help or leave him in the background. Make it prayerful. Jacqueline, I need to quote your dad for a moment. That'd be okay? Thank you. If you don't want me to, I won't. But your dad didn't seem shy. Okay. All right. Mr. Jack, we were talking Friday night. We had talked on a lot of topics. But he asked me a huge question. He said, Brother Steve, do you think we are moving closer or are we moving away? And I had to specify, you mean that our whole country, our census that I talked to you about before, that 2010 census asking every American citizen about their household showed the startling fact that 1/3 of Americans claim no religion. No religion. Christianity is dominant. But 1/3 of 300 million is 100 million people have no religion. We have a huge work to do. Jack, we're moving away from God. So we need to make it prayerful. How do we make it prayerful for our leaders? Billy Graham Association has a guide to help pray for our leaders. I just give you three pieces here. I hope to have this guide in the prayer room on election day. First one for Proverbs 11:14 and Proverbs 15:22. Help so-and-so to accept wise counsel. We might put in, help Barack Obama to accept wise counsel. That's a good prayer. It blesses him, blesses us. Secondly, give Matt, our governor, the courage to do the right thing, even when urged to do the wrong thing. Proverbs 2:11-15. Give him the courage to do the right. Thirdly, Colossians 3:12. Give our judge executive, give Mike a tender heart of compassion toward those that he leads and serves. We can put the name of our leader in there. We can put the name of our bishop in there. Help Bishop Leonard Fairley, our district superintendent. You can put my name in there. Help our leaders have wise counsel, the courage to do the right thing, be tender compassion. Let's make it prayerful. If we don't, I'll get to that moment. And lastly, is make it public. Make it public. Nancy Smith, she got to judge a talent contest yesterday. All right, she's probably sitting there with her scorecard now, judging me. I'll get a sermon printed out here afterwards. She'll rate me. Content, coherency, flow, logic, etc. But she was judging a Farm Bureau talent show, and she said, and actually I asked her, how many of the songs were Christian songs? And she said, 3 out of 6. Half of the songs were Christian songs. So I got more curious. Which ones? How Great Thou Art was sung twice by two contestants. And then my brain is bringing Beulahland up. There it is. Sweet Beulahland was the other one. Of course, then I asked, which one won? How Great Thou Art. One of the gals was saying How Great Thou Art won the whole thing. And Nancy picked that one. She gave good scores there. Not because of Christian song, because the gal sang well. But do you see how those songs were in the public? In a secular talent show, the songs of God. Do you realize the power when one of these songs of God is on national television, on American Idol, or on The Voice, and someone sings a song of God? Oceans or something like that? Wow! The gospel that we know. Make it public. Make it public. In the early service, I talked to Easton Bryan. A song popped in my mind as soon as I started the sermon Monday morning about making it public. It's, now, if you've never heard of the Doobie Brothers, you're sitting there and go, who? But if you've heard of the Doobie Brothers, they have a song titled Taking to the Streets. Taking to the Streets. And we may learn that next year as a theme song. Say you have to start the year off in January with Taking to the Streets. Easton will be right next to you. And one of the lines in that song, a songwriter writes this. I don't like what I think I see. I don't like what I think I see. I don't like what I think I see. I think I see a lot of violence. I think I see a lot of greed. I think I see a lot of immorality. I don't like what I think I see. And we as the church have got to make it public. We are not at all restricted from affecting the laws and voting and electing. I'm so glad Franklin Graham in Frankfurt called on people, consider running for public office. Wow, I've never heard a Christian exhort people to run for public office, but how else do you get public office unless you run? I close with this. We need to make it public, and here's why. Because Edmund Burke, and you've probably heard this, I hope you memorize it. He said years ago, the only thing necessary for the triumph of evil is for good men to do nothing. Good men, like like Judaism citizens, stay home and not fight. Evil will win. Good women, to stay home, not vote, not speak. You might as well hand the keys over to Satan. But, praise God, there have always been Christian people who have risen up to speak for Him. Sometimes we win, sometimes we don't. But we need to stand up and speak for our Lord. We are His ambassadors. And we are polite, and we are in order, and we are very clear. There is one God, and one Lord, and one Savior. Let's make it personal. Let's make it prayerful.